El Shaddai, bless you guys, brothers and sisters. Thanks for coming back. I just want to hit 2 points today. First point is in Matthew 25, Jesus Christ, the parable of the talents. He gave one servant 5 talents, one servant 2 talents, and one servant 1 talent, according to their ability. This is another reason why we can't judge each other, is because we don't start out all at the same place. There might be a brother and sister out there who was raised in an attic, was abused physically, sexually, mentally by their father and mother, was fed dog food, and was only given 2 pairs of clothes. Okay? So for them, they were given 1 talent, but yet they're going to be judged based on what they did with that. We have been given something. Jesus Christ has given us something. So for the person who's raised in the attic, if they take one of their sets of clothes, and maybe they give it away, maybe they give it to somebody else who needs it. Granted, on the grand scale of things, maybe with somebody who's been given 10 talents, they can easily judge that person and say, what did you do with your life? You only gave one set of clothes away. But they doubled their talent. While the person with 10 talents, they hardly use them at all. But yet what they do, quote unquote, it looks better than what that person in the attic did. But in the realm of kingdom, of the King of Kings, when he looks down and judges those 2 servants, who do you think is going to bless more? It's what we've been given is what we'll be judged on. In that vein, you have been given something. And so stop crying out for more. What you need to be crying out for is, Holy Spirit, what have you given me right now that I'm not being faithful in? You know, do you have headaches? And Holy Spirit, you know, please show me what's the cause of these headaches? And does the Holy Spirit lead you to, let's say, aspartame? You know, you research aspartame and you find out, yeah, this ain't good. This ain't good for me. What have you done with that? Do you still drink 5 Diet Cokes a day? Or do you obey? Do you believe that the Holy Spirit answered your prayer? He showed you aspartame shouldn't be consumed by you or your children. What have you done with that? Have you stopped drinking Diet Coke, even though you love it? You absolutely love it. So the next time you pray with a fridge full of Diet Coke and saying, Lord, I want more, give me more knowledge, the Holy Spirit's like, why don't you obey what I've already told you? I'm waiting on you. My second point is, I understand that we need to study to show ourselves approved. We need to be wise as serpents, innocent as doves. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, didn't start his full-time ministry until he was 29, 30. Paul, after his road to Damascus experience, he went to the desert of Arabia and studied for 3 years before he came back out. I understand that we need to study and know what we're talking about and be able to give an account. But there's a demonic lie that we have to have every little nook and cranny figured out before we're going to step out. I mean, again, the Holy Spirit has given us something. Something. God has moved on your behalf somehow, somewhere, saved you, whatever. Did you bury it? Did you let your friends and family know because you're afraid that they're going to laugh at you? Have you been delivered of demons, but you don't want to tell your Christians that? I mean, you're a new person. They see it in your face. But you're embarrassed to tell them that you had demons? But here's the thing. If you want to feel like you have to have everything figured out, every single scenario before you go out and preach the gospel, every single scenario before you go out and deliver your friends and family, you're never going to be ready. That is a demonic lie. You know, it sounds good. Oh, I don't want to hurt people. You know, I want to have an answer for the King. I want to be a good representative of Jesus Christ. Those are all good sounding terms, but in the end, you'll never be ready because the Holy Spirit is waiting for you to step out with what he's given you. See if you're faithful and then you'll get more. It's also pride and ego and arrogance, and we fear man. We fear man's judgments. And so we want to have everything figured out before we step out. You will make mistakes. Praise God. you will make mistakes. That's how we learn. That's how we learn. You just have to accept that fact. It's the Holy Spirit that guides us and teaches us. My first deliverance, I had my first deliverance before I was even delivered. And I look back and it truly was a deliverance on training wheels. I didn't ask for it. My roommate just started manifesting. Face started contorting, balling up his fist. And I just knew two things. Get their name, and if they have the legal right, then take care of the legal right and then cast it out. That's all I knew. I was way over my head. But the Holy Spirit was with me. I had no fear. God walked me through it. I learned a lot from that, just my first deliverance. And that increases your faith. So you step out, you know, the Holy Spirit guides you through the moment, guides you through the ministry, increases your faith. You make a mistake, Holy Spirit corrects you. Hey, this is what you need to do next time. Or, hey, this isn't working, try this. Oh, that works really good. You know, Holy Spirit will walk it with you. You will make mistakes. Praise God for it. We shouldn't have it all figured out, because if we had it all figured out, then we'll screw it up royally, because it's all about us and we can boast about it. Step out. It's a demonic lie saying that you have to have it all figured out. You have to research 20 different ministries that do deliverance or do healing. David Hogan is a Mexican missionary, and the guy is very, very stable in the way he's walked through 30, 40 years of ministry. The guy walks in power and miracles. So let's listen to how he was educated and the choices he made.
You know, when my wife and I first went to Mexico, it was like 33 years ago. My kids, all of them were little bitty. We didn't know the language. We didn't have any backing, financial, or we didn't have anything. I was raised in a Southern Baptist church. I come out of the thing. I got filled with the Holy Ghost in the mid-70s. And so they basically threw me out. And that's all right. I'm still in their books and that. That's okay. And, and God spoke to me to go to Mexico. And these wealthy people that were friends of my daddy was the secretary for the convention in the state of Louisiana for 25 years. He was a very powerful man with them. Very educated fella in that. He come to me and he said, these people are going to pay for your education up to a doctorate. They want you to, you got it paid for you and your wife for all, ever how many years it takes. And we'd like for you to get education. You can go do what you want to, but we'd like you to go do it educated. So I went and fasted for 10 days. And God never told me to do it their way. So I went, seemingly out of rebellion, to the only elders I had in my life at the time was a whole bunch of Southern Baptist fellas. And it seemed like I was not listening to them. I was headstrong, and I was doing what I wanted to do over what they thought was right. And it's possible that was true. It is. I look back on it now, and I see all these young men that are in our work, and you know, and all these guys, and they all got these strong ideas, and I have to make allowances for that, because I did it myself. But the 9 years that it would have taken me to get my education, I went down there, I got shot, I got beat, I got left for dead 3 times, I got imprisoned 45 times. So let me ask you a question. You that believe that your education is more powerful than God. The education I received, was it more valuable than the one I would have received? Having a doctorate at the end of my name, would that have given me more power than I have right now? I received God's education, and it's a lot harder. But the value now, you can't put monetary value on it. There's nothing you can put on it that would add up to or stand up against it. You understand or not? I don't want to be complicated. I just want you to understand that I believe in both ways. Whatever God tells you to do, help yourself. Be the best at it.
So if you feel like you're unworthy and you're unworthy to step out in what God has already given you, to start loving your neighbor, to start walking in miracles, let's study the story about Legion. Remember him, the demoniac that met Jesus?
And they went out to see what it was that was done. And they came to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. And they that saw it told them how it befell to him that was possessed with the devil and also concerning the swine. And they began to pray him to depart out of their coasts. And when he was come into the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but saith unto him, Go home to thy friends, and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee, and hath had compassion on thee. And he departed, and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him, and all men did marvel.
So here's a man that lived in the tombs cutting himself, still had maybe still open wounds on his arms, falls at the feet of Jesus, gets delivered, and he becomes this great evangelist in Decapolis, which means the 10 cities. So it didn't say he just went to one city. It said he went to Decapolis, which is an area surrounded by 10 cities. So if you feel like you're unworthy, you know, you don't have the right education, you don't sound right, you say the wrong words sometimes, you're not polished, you wear the wrong socks, you don't swing your sword at the appropriate angle that other people like you to swing your sword at, who cares? Walk it out. You've been given something. Be faithful in it. Always have your eyes on Jesus and focused on the enemy. Okay? I know the enemy wants to put people behind you. You know, the enemy sees you on the front line, so he wants to put people behind you to come stab you in the back. Can't worry about them. Can't take your eyes off the enemy, all right? Who cares if you're not swinging your sword the right way or you have red socks on and today's black sock day? You know, we're always going to make mistakes. And holier-than-thou Christians who walk in no power, walk in no love, they're always going to point it out to you. You just can't worry about them, okay?
1 Corinthians 2, And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God.
I like to end with a prayer. Let's just seek the Holy Spirit together. So if you just repeat after me, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I ask for your forgiveness for being disobedient. Holy Spirit, please reveal to me what you have given me that I'm not being faithful in. Holy Spirit, I want more of you. Show me right now in what areas I'm being disobedient.